Hello everyone and good morning. It's my pleasure to have you here on this fourth webinar, part of our series Navigating the Just Transition. So today we'll focus on the role of energy communities in the just transition process. And just a few words at the beginning from my side. So while the just transition concept can be understood in many different contexts, there's always one common thing of it, the goal to build sustainable and people-centered societies. In the context of today's highly unpredictable energy sector marked by supply shocks and price volatility, we have to stick to the solutions that will bring and build decentralized energy systems. And one of those solutions, and I think everyone will agree, are energy communities. So I think we need them more than ever right now, and that's why we are here to discuss them, discuss their benefits, why they're important, and put them in the context of the just transition process. So my name is Joanna Jakubowska, and I'm a just transition policy officer at CE Bankwatch Network. And I have an absolute pleasure to present you our wonderful panelists that agreed to join us today. So we have Ioana Teodosiu from the Green Tank. She is a policy associate focusing on community energy and energy democracy. Chris Bretos is a finance project manager at Rescop EU, a federation of European Federation of Citizen Energy Cooperatives. And last but not least, we have Poyan Maleki Dizaji, who is a senior consultant at Ecoris. So we have a really, really wonderful team today with us. And I'm sure that we'll be hearing a lot of very fascinating and insightful information. And as for the agenda, we will start with the presentation from Chris, who will present the concept of energy communities, as it's still a very, not very, but relatively a new concept. I think it's very important to remind what we are actually talking about. So this will be Chris with his first intervention. Then we'll jump to a specific case study, and Joanna will provide an insight into the situation of energy communities in lignite areas in Greece. And lastly, Poyan will present the new technical assistance in just transition regions in the Czech Republic, with the goal of building and creating more energy communities in those regions. So this is the plan for this 1 hour. But as we know, all webinars, seminars, conferences are absolutely not the same without questions from the audience. So I very, very much invite you and encourage you to ask questions by putting them simply to the chat or the Q&A box. Panelists will have time to answer them straight after their presentations or at the end of the webinar. So last information from my side is that this webinar is being recorded and will be put on our website as well as YouTube channel. So without further ado, I will hand over to Chris to tell us a bit more about energy communities and just provide insight into this concept.
Thanks a lot, Joanna. Thanks a lot, Joanna. Good morning, everyone. I'm gonna jump straight to it by presenting. Here we go. And as Joanna said, my name is Chris Vretos. I'm a financing project manager at Rescop EU, the European Federation of Citizen Energy Cooperatives. Many of you probably already know it. It's a not-for-profit association based in Belgium. It represents more than 1,900 energy cooperatives from across Europe, which in turn represent more than 1.2 million European citizens, which goes to show really the scale and the speed of the cooperative energy transition as it unfolds across Europe. So very quickly, what is an energy cooperative? Broadly, we define it as a group of citizens that jointly cooperate on energy transition projects. Usually, energy communities, let's call them, take distinct legal forms, are legal entities. But usually, and we see that in many European countries, that they adopt the national legislative framework equates energy communities based on the law of cooperatives, which means that they also closely align with the 7 International Cooperative Alliance principles, such as that they are democratically controlled by their members through a one member, one vote system. There is a concern for community, meaning that many times energy communities, as do cooperatives, they reinvest a lot of their profits within their local communities. They're autonomous and independent, so they're actually effectively owned and controlled by their members. So just very briefly to take a quick step back and say that we see really the grand potential of energy cooperatives to radically shift the energy system towards a democratic transition. And that was actually modeled by the Technical University of Delft through this 2016 study that showed that half of EU citizens could be producing their own energy by 2050, meeting 45% of the EU's energy demand, whereas a staggering 89% of all citizens could be participating in some sort of energy system activity, including, for example, charging their electric cars or demand response, energy efficiency, housing renovations. So really this monumental, let's say, potential of energy of citizens to participate in the energy transition was legally acknowledged by the European Commission in 2019 with a package of directives called Clean Energy for All Europeans. This defines renewable energy communities based on the recast Renewable Energy Directive and citizen energy communities based on the recast Internal Electricity Market Directive. So it's two, but very closely aligned, let's say, forms of citizen organization, but not just citizens, all sorts of stakeholders are, let's say, encouraged by the Commission to participate in such schemes, including municipalities, small and medium-sized enterprises, associations, NGOs, pretty much everything except for large corporations, let's say, or businesses whose main area of activity is in the energy sector. This package, in turn, requires all member states to ensure that they have a national legislative framework in place by the latest by summer 2021, which recognizes and supports energy communities. As you can imagine, we're in 2023. There's still some countries that have failed to bring forward adequate legislation. So we're really pushing across all of the EU 27 to ensure that citizens can now cannot exercise this legally recognized right of theirs to participate in the energy transition collectively. So what kind of activities can citizen energy cooperatives focus on? Everything, basically, any sort of energy system activity that you can think of, including the traditional production, but also supply, distribution, flexibility. This is very important, as you know, increasing levels of renewable energy penetrate into the grid. Citizens will have to be much more active through the day, through demand response, by getting, for example, signals in their houses from smart meters telling them that now there's a lot of renewable energy penetrating into the grid because it's the middle of the day. So now you should turn on your washing machine or you should charge your car. So energy communities could aggregate that, these processes of demand response. But there's all sorts of other things such as transportation, electric car sharing, energy saving, and collective home retrofits, and so on. And now the reason why I believe that energy communities are levers for a just energy transition, which we're going to hear much more from my colleagues later on, is because, first of all, they are transforming the way that we use energy and other resources. They're decommodifying energy, transforming it from a commodity into a common good. We see on the graph on the bottom right, it's the it's from Ecopower, the largest Belgian energy cooperative, which is also a supplier. And you can see the green line, which is the price of electricity from Ecopower to its customers throughout the energy crisis, so throughout the past year, compared with the red line, which is the price of energy from commercial suppliers in Belgium. And as you can see, Ecopower has consistently kept prices lower exactly because its goal is to deliver local energy security, it's to tackle energy poverty, and it's to include citizens in the energy transition. It's not to make profit. So we are seeing this tendency of energy communities actually reinvesting a lot of their profits to more renewable energy projects, tackling energy poverty, promoting social justice. It's not about making profit. So it is about reorienting our ideas, our systemic perspectives towards energy. It's all about democratic governance, as I said. In many countries, I've mentioned this before, energy communities are cooperatives, which means that each member has one vote, which creates all sorts of transparency checks and balances in how these energy communities are operated. There's a general assembly where every member casts their vote. There's a board of directors. There's an oversight board to ensure that all finances are, let's say, handled with transparency. We're also seeing energy communities across the EU. I'm mentioning the example of Goiener here, that are putting forth gender equality and inclusion action plans to ensure that the energy transition doesn't just end up benefiting some middle-class, white, educated men, which is often the case. Well, up to today, people are now trying to change that with genuine inclusion policies. And Rescu, for example, is working to make this a statutory commitment within the Rescu EU statute, but also encouraging its members to do the same, to have a gender just equality clause within their statutes. But to do all of this, to actually achieve a just transition through energy communities, we do have a missing ingredient, which is targeted public finance, which can be used to de-risk community energy investments, but also crowd in further private finance, as is the case, for example, in just transition regions, which really desperately need this public finance to come in and promote all sorts of social justice and just transition goals, such as maintaining youth in the local areas, promoting local energy security, and so on. So I'm just gonna very briefly, for the second part of this presentation, talk about this project that we've been working on, that both of the Ioannas here have contributed to, and I'm thankful to them for that. It's a public financing tracker that Rescu, together with Bankwatch and Climate Action Network, have built to look at whether 19 EU member states are using their public funds, such as from the Recovery and Resilience Fund, Modernization Fund, and Cohesion Funds, to support energy communities. What we did is we mobilized campaigners from across the EU to have a look at these national funding plans and strategies. And then we corroborated the findings with bilaterally discussing with other NGOs as well as managing authorities. And then we basically created, let's say, an analytical framework on how well and if member states are supporting energy communities, based on what kind of activities they're supporting, if the plans are transparent and inclusive, the level of budget they're allocating, and so on. And then we graded along four colors. So with red being the worst, green being the best. Red for countries that are basically not doing anything. They're not using public funds to support energy communities. And green for countries that are really dedicating specific funds. They're doing it transparently. They're supporting all sorts of activities in the energy sector, and so on. And I'm going to very quickly gloss through these maps just to give you an overlook. At the end of the presentation, you can actually see the link, so you can explore the tracker yourselves. But as you can see, the results are not super encouraging, meaning that in most countries, except for, usually Italy and Spain in this case, member states are failing to use their public funds to support energy communities. And what makes Italy and Spain stand out is, as I said before, they're allocating hundreds of millions of euros to support energy communities with public funds, but also to promote just transition purposes for these regions through their cohesion funding, for example. So they are looking at, let's say, deserted rural areas or areas that are depopulated and saying that we're going to give specific grants to such areas to create energy communities, build local energy security, create new job opportunities in the area, maintain youth in the area. So I think all of these are highly related to promoting a just energy transition. Just as I'm moving towards the closing of the presentation, because I know Ioanna is looking at me saying, when is he going to end? We are now planning to do a coaching workshop with energy communities from across Europe, actually showing them what public funds are presently available and explaining to them how they can apply for them. And we're also providing ad hoc support to managing authorities, basically advising them on how to build these public financing programs around the needs of energy communities, but also around the needs of targeting specific just transition and social inclusion goals. Because this is for us the most important thing in this conversation, not to misappropriate public funds, but to make sure that they actually reach local communities, local beneficiaries, and they have a tangible impact on the ground. I'm going to close off with this sister project of ours. It's a consortium of NGOs from Central and Eastern Europe, and they are ringing the bell of how a lot of countries right now are absorbing these hundreds of millions of euros in EU funds, but potentially actually supporting fossil fuels, contravening the rule of law, really not including civil society or citizens whatsoever in all of these processes, so creating intransparent, opaque situations. So really we are, let's say, joining this bandwagon and also saying that we need to make sure that EU money goes to energy communities, but authentic citizen-led energy communities that are having a tangible impact on their ground. They're including energy poor households, they're promoting gender equality, they're building local energy sufficiency, and so on. Please take 1 second to copy and paste this into your browser. And of course, I'm happy to also send it in the chat afterwards. That's the tracker that I was talking about. Thanks a lot, and happy to answer any questions in the end.
Thank you very much, Chris. And I actually already put the link in the chat to the tracker, so I invite you to have a look at it. Thank you for this very insightful presentation. I think it's built perfectly a ground for further discussion. I can see that there's already one question in the Q&A box, so I'll ask you this question, and it's about the carbon capture. So I'm not sure if you can see it, but I will read it. So Chris mentioned tackling carbon capture in favor of more citizen inclusion. Would you also say that there is a need to reduce municipal capture as well in order to, again, prioritize citizens' direct involvement more than entities, even if of public authorities supposed to be working on behalf of citizens?
Should we address this now or in the end? How do you want to do it, Anna?
Right now.
Okay. I can maybe go first, but I'm sure Pouyan and both Ioannas, you have something to say because it's a very hot topic right now. It's not easy to answer. I maybe can say that generally RescuPU's line is that energy communities should always include citizens. That doesn't preclude also including municipalities, SMEs, associations, other legal entities, but for us, yeah, citizen inclusion is, let's say, the canary in the coal mine of whether is this like an actual authentic energy community. Having said that, there's a multitude of ways that municipalities can support energy communities, even by not being a member, such as providing access to public spaces for an energy community to install a project. Even just providing an office where an energy community can meet a local community and plan, through dissemination activities, through concessions and procurement. So let's say buying energy that is actually produced from a local energy community. So there's a multitude of ways. I'm fully in favor of municipality being an actual voting member of an energy community. And we're seeing great examples from Greece as well, where I'm from, where our biggest energy community in the island of Crete actually has municipalities from across the island. So, and that's working really well. So I think that can be definitely a win-win.
Perfect. Thank you, Chris. I can see that Poyan unmuted himself. So go ahead if you want to elaborate.
I fully agree with Chris there. There's so many multiplier effects of having municipalities involved. I'm curious to the person who asked the question, not critical, but just curious, what's the concern of municipal capture? Because, of course, corporate capture, you can understand that perhaps a business or a profit-making company would want to you know, be, change a little bit the nature and the focus and let's say the objectives of the community. But I'm curious to hear what the concern is about having municipal capture. What could be the downside of that? Is it that they might have too much power and influence over the community, over citizens, or yeah? I'm not sure if it's possible to respond to that question or not, but it's something I'd like to know.
So we already have an answer from this anonymous attendee in the Q&A box. So basically just concerned of municipalities establishing renewable energy communities, but not involving citizens, but still claiming its equivalent.
I think that's a legitimate concern, yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, Chris, Poyan, for answers. Thank you for the questions from our attendee. And now, being aware of time, I will hand over to Joanna to give us, an insight and more information on how our energy community is doing in Greece and specifically in lignite areas. So here we have this very direct link to the just transition process. So Joanna, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. Let me share my screen. Tell me if it's okay.
Not yet.
Now?
Yes.
Okay. Perfect. So, thank you, Joanna. I'm Joanna Felusiu from the Green Tank, a think tank based in Athens. So we're working a lot on just transition and community energy. Today, we'll provide a short overview of the course of energy communities in Greece and their role in just transition. And I hope I will offer recommendations out from our experience that could be useful also to other core regions across the EU. I will start by trying to answer the following question. Why are energy communities important for a just transition? Chris said a lot about that, but my first quick answer would be because they ensure energy democracy and they incorporate all the features needed to make the transition just. And these features are none other than active participation of local communities in the transition, the decentralization of energy resources, the development of renewable energy projects. There is obviously no question of switching to other fossil fuel, such as fossil gas, but only to RES. And they also secure direct access to the economic benefits of the transition for the local communities. And all the above create ownership of the transition and finally lead to the maintenance of social cohesion. And in the face of the monoculture of big RES projects in former coal regions, energy communities promote a model of energy production and consumption that is smaller in scale, adapted to local needs, and people-centered. But for local communities to benefit from the tool of energy communities, they need support. And the first step is a supportive and enabling legal framework. Now let's zoom in the Greek case. The basis for the development of energy communities in Greece was a law adopted in 2018. The law provided for the definition of energy communities, who could participate, the activities that an energy community could undertake, the establishment procedure, and others. It was a really enabling framework that led to the development of energy communities, and today we have 1,406 active energy communities nationwide. Very recently, in March, we have the second important legislative benchmark, the transposition of the two European directives that also Greece mentioned, the Renewables Directive and the Internal Market Directive. And there is a new law about energy communities that repeals the founding law of 2018 and it introduces two new categories, two new definitions of energy communities, renewable energy communities and citizens' energy communities. And also has new provisions on participation, activities for each category and locality. In Greece, energy communities are defined as civil cooperatives, and their main aim is to provide environmental, economic, and social benefit rather than financial gain. Now, let's see how energy community projects developed since 2018. In Greece, energy communities are mainly active in the electricity production sector, and they operate two categories of projects. First, RES projects to sell energy for profit, and the second one, projects that aim to meet the energy needs of the members of the community or local needs, and do not generate any immediate monetary gains. In these two diagrams, you can see the development of energy community projects of both categories since 2018, when the funding law was activated. The first diagram shows the development of commercial projects that generate profits. Since 2018, they developed faster, and they present today the majority of the projects with 800 megawatts of installed capacity. And the second diagram shows how self-production projects evolved since 2018. We see a much slower development, and these projects are only 3.17 megawatts. So we can say that in Greece, energy communities were mainly developed as a form of entrepreneurship to generate profits from electricity rather than to meet local needs or the needs of the community's members. But what is interesting is that during the last year, the year of the energy crisis, citizens turned to renewables and to self-production individually or collectively. You see here that the requests for and self-production projects by energy communities multiplied by five, while the projects for profit showed a much smaller increase. And specifically, the capacity requested for self-production projects by energy community jumped from almost 9 megawatts to 86 megawatts. Now let's turn to the lignite regions. Greece has two lignite regions, Western Macedonia and Megalopolis in Arcadia. And the energy tradition in these areas led to increased participation of citizens in energy communities. In Western Macedonia specifically, we see significant interest. There are 261 energy communities, and the region ranks second in the number of active energy communities and fifth in the installed capacity of community energy projects nationwide. Also is second regarding the requests for self-production projects. But the main picture, the big picture, remains the same as described before. The majority of the projects operate for profit. We have 100 projects of 63 megawatts of installed capacity, and only one project of 300 kilowatts for self-production. And compared to Western Macedonia, energy communities' momentum in Arcadia, in Megalopoli, is clearly weaker. There are 21 energy communities operating, and we have 9 projects for profit of 5 megawatts and no self-production project. Crucial role in the deployment of energy communities play the available resources, and the tracker that Chris described is very useful. In Greece, we have now 2 concrete funding schemes specifically for energy communities in the lignite regions, but they have not been able yet to channel resources to the ground, to local communities. The first one is national resources for just transition. Greece has an innovative policy measure compared to EU standards. Since 2018, part of the public revenue from the auctioning of CO2 allowances are channeled for the just transition of the lignite regions. Until now, these resources amount 127 million. Of these, 62 million corresponding to the years 2018 and 2019 have been allocated and are currently deployed. But only 3 million is earmarked for energy communities. And it's not certain yet that this measure will continue. Resources for the rest of the years still remain unused. The second stream is the Just Transition Fund. The Just Transition Development Program for 21-27 forces resources for energy community projects such as energy efficiency, heat pump installation, renewables, and others that amount up to 132 million, but those have not yet been activated. However, we can be optimistic that in the coming period, by activating all the above mentioned funds, energy communities will be practically supported in the lignite regions. But for their further development, we need to remove other existing barriers. Apart from the funds absorption that I already mentioned, there is no priority to self-production projects with proven difficulties in obtaining financing and access to bank lending. Moreover, the limited grid availability becomes number one problem at the moment. The rejections of projects requests by energy communities reach 49%, and there is a low rate of electrification of self-production energy community projects. And also distortions continue to exist at the expense of non-for-profit energy communities that develop self-production projects. So to conclude, energy communities are an essential tool for a truly just transition in the lignite regions. However, support is needed. From our experience, it is important to make sure that renewable energy projects by energy communities, that their investments are included in the territorial just transition plans. Although those plans have recently been finalized, there will be a review period. So it's crucial to render energy communities eligible for funding from the Just Transition Fund, the European Fund. Also, available resources, European or national, should be activated as soon as possible to support community energy projects. And those funds should focus on subsidies for the installation costs of energy community projects to meet own energy needs. And they can also support a development fund specifically for energy communities. We should also prioritize self-production projects by energy communities with strong citizen participation and give incentives for cooperation with large renewable companies and energy communities through shareholding. Moreover, we need an ambitious policy for community energy that should be reflected in the national energy and climate plans. So we need to set specific, ambitious and quantitative targets in the NECP, the current NECP revision. And finally, we need to protect energy communities from unfair competitive processes. We need to ensure equal terms of participation in the energy market for energy communities. That's the situation in Greece. Thank you, and happy to answer to your questions.
Thank you very much, Ioana. Indeed, it was a really fascinating case study. And I think in the context of the just transition process, it's really crucial to have a specific country where something is happening in those coal heavily, for a very long time, heavily dependent on fossil fuels regions. So thank you for shedding a light on the situation in Greece. And my question, because I don't see anything in the Q&A chat, my question would be, as we are talking very much about a regional level, I was wondering about the role of local authorities in the development of energy communities. So do you see that they're maybe actively engaged in those regions, maybe not that much? And yeah, if they're not, what would be also your advice? How they could maybe strengthen their support.
Okay, being active in just transition means that local communities are active, and local communities are citizens, are municipalities, are SMEs, are everyone, is everyone involved, everyone living over there. So yes, local authorities play a crucial role by activating people being active during the whole just transition procedure. And they are also very important players in the energy community field. In Western Macedonia, we have six energy communities with created by municipalities, and we have one in Megalopolis. The energy community of Kozani was created in 2018, immediately after the first law we had in the country. And they are now preparing their first project. It's a solar PV of 8 megawatts. And as far as I know, all the others try to mature their projects and involve citizens. And Chris described also the energy community in Creta it's a self-production project. They operate, and the local authorities also participate. In other regions, for example, in Attica, we see NGOs also helping the creation of energy communities and involve citizens. So, I think all players are needed at this stage, especially in the lignite regions. People turn to the municipalities, so they do have a significant role. And they, and in Greece at the moment, they are trying to create a more participatory procedure, if I answer.
Yes, it definitely answers my question. I can see that there is one more question in the chat from Yuoslava Stempin. With Greece's huge increase in energy communities last year, do you see the interest growing, or because of all the issues with setting them up, are people getting disheartened?
I'm not sure people getting disheartened. Okay, we have in Greece at the moment, we have to find a balance among the commercial projects and the self-production projects. And I think that the last year, what showed is that people turned to renewables, turned to energy communities. As far as I know, we have more and I also gave you the number that they multiplied by 5 the requests, which means that people see that their future is there, and they are trying to be active. I don't know how we will go on because of all the barriers I already mentioned, and specifically the grid inavailability. And but I don't think people are yet this how we say that this disheartened. No, I think we remain optimistic and struggling.
Good. So despite of all of the barriers and challenges, it's good to stay optimistic. So thank you for keeping it this way, Joanna. So now we will move from Greece to the Czech Republic. And Pujan will tell us a bit more about the newly established support for creation and growth of energy communities in the just transition regions, in the Czech just transition regions. So we have two Pujans right now, but I hope one of you will present.
Thanks very much. Yeah, I shared the link together with our colleague David, and he also appears as Pujan. But we'll share the slides and also introduce our team in a moment.
Okay, we can see the presentation, but not in the full screen.
Just one moment. Unfortunately, we're having difficulties to put it on full screen, but I think we can get by like this for
you, you can just go ahead.
Here we go. I think it's slow.
Okay, something is happening, so I think we can just leave it this way. And in the meantime, if you fix it, that would be great. But
yeah, no worries. Then.
No, it's perfect.
We're messaging. Yeah. No.
No, it's okay.
Excellent. Well, first of all, thank you very much, Joanna, for inviting us to participate in this discussion. And thanks a lot to Chris and Joanna for the important work on this topic and really interesting insights. My name is Puyan Maleki, and I'm a senior consultant at Ecaris. And I'm going to give you some preliminary insights into a project which Ecaris, together with our partners, B Partner, are delivering for the European Commission's DG Regio, supporting the implementation of energy communities in Czech just transition regions. We can go to the next slide, please.
I think now we lost Puyan.
Yeah.
Oh.
Back. Apologies, we are having both internet and technical difficulties here today from the office, but
I can also share my screen because I have your presentation.
That would be great, Joanna. Perfect. Apologies again about this.
Someone was faster.
Great. Perfect. And then there is Ecaris involved as a partner with offices across Europe, but working mainly on European level research and consulting for particularly the European Commission services. And we currently have a leadership on two very interesting and central Commission initiatives, relation and coal regions. We're working for DGN and leading on the Secretariat for the initiative of coal regions in transition. And we're also supporting DG Regio in the operation of the Just Transition platform. We also have quite an extensive track record on energy communities, delivering on the Rural Energy Community Advisory Hub for DG ENA, and have participated in other Horizon projects on the topic as well. We can go to the next slide, please. So why was this project launched? I think the presentation's gone. Joanna?
It was Gabriela presenting it.
Sorry about this.
No worries. I hope we'll manage.
Okay, we're back. So the context of this project is very much under the framework of the European Green Deal, as well as the launch of the Just Transition Mechanism and the Just Transition Fund. In a nutshell, what the project seeks to achieve is raise awareness on energy communities in the Czech Republic, and particularly to develop recommendations on how to develop energy communities, not only all across the Czech Republic, but with a particular focus on the just transition regions. And a key means of us doing so is through various workshops and dissemination activities to promote this knowledge. If we can go to the next slide, please. Is it possible to go to, I'm not sure who's controlled right now.
We are controlling this.
Are we able to see now?
Yes.
Yeah. So here's a little bit of a map of where the Czech-free just transition regions are. Apologies for my pronunciation. I'm not Czech myself, but it Ústí nad Labem region, Karlovy Vary, and Moravian Silesian region. Why is there a focus on these regions? First of all, economic challenges, which these regions have been facing for quite some time now, lagging behind EU averages. Secondly, and perhaps most importantly, is the carbon intensive focus of these regions, with significant amounts of coal mining, coal generation, and overall fossil fuel dependence in these regions. And we see, for example, in the Moravian Silesian region, there's a dependence of around 60% of their energy comes from coal sources. People in these regions are suffering from almost double the levels of electricity prices which they had in 2021 in 2022 as compared to 2021. And overall, these regions are suffering from a relatively low progression of renewables. On the topic of where do energy communities stand in Czech Republic at the moment, there's very few. And what there does exist are mere pilot projects, which are very much spearheaded by local municipality, and actual bottom-up, genuine citizen-led initiative. Moreover, the Czech Republic, it has to be a largely centralized energy system, which historically is not accommodated so much for community involvement or perhaps energy cooperative initiatives. And perhaps the most important, let's say, barrier that we noted on the outset is the lack of transposition of EU legislation of both the definition, the rights and support to the energy communities. And you can see on the right the excellent work of Rescoop on this matter to basically to map and grade the lack of progress which the European countries are going through on the topic of energy community. So both in terms of the definition, the enabling framework and the support schemes, the Czech Republic has been lagging behind quite substantially. And this underlines why the DG Regio chose to intervene and support on this matter. A little bit more about our project, actually. What are we doing and what are we producing and how are we trying to address this situation? This project started only in February and will last until next January. So we are in early stages, but we're in a really critical moment now in developing our draft diagnostic report, basically, whereby we map the socioeconomic conditions, the legal institutional framework, the key actors who are involved, liaise with them, consult them, carry out a series of desk research related activities, with the ultimate objective of painting and characterizing what are specific barriers which are being faced in the Czech Republic, in the just transition regions, and scoping out what could be the potential drivers which can overcome the barriers which are being faced for the development of community energy here. Building on the diagnostic report, we will be developing a handbook which incorporates the results of our analysis, but with a couple of more practical elements involved too. First of all, we're going to be building on existing guidance from, for example, Rescoop or a Rural Energy Community Advisory Hub, the Energy Community Repository, the various practical and step-by-step guidance which is already out there on what communities and citizens need to actually consolidate their efforts and build an energy community. So we'll be tailoring our analyses and the existing materials to provide some practical guidance to initiators in the Czech Republic, and supporting this with a series of good practices whereby energy communities have been developed both across Europe, perhaps also in the Czech Republic, energy community in coal and carbon intensive regions. Many at the end of all of this, we'll be carrying out a series of information sessions and tailor-made shops in order to disseminate our findings, to receive further feedback from those who are interested, and to provide a little bit more tailored and concrete capacity building to those who actually want to take action by themselves. Who have we been involving in the project? And I think this is a real important part, and I think a credit to the design of the project is the significant and comprehensive engagement of stakeholders, which we are carrying out. We have a steering committee, which meets on a monthly basis to steer the direction, the decision making, and review the progress of the project. And as you can see here, there's a number of really important actors on the European level, on the national level, and the then as part of our research, and particularly thanks to our partners at B Partner, we've been really reaching out to all of the relevant stakeholders on the territories, understanding their perspectives and taking that into our account, into our analysis. So to give you some preliminary insights onto in our results, and this is something we'll be developing further in the next month and looking forward to sharing a more complete version in the coming months. But to give you some preliminary insights, we ultimately found that the regulatory and legislative barriers are the critical obstacles for the development of community energy. First of all, that there is insufficient legislation on covering topics under the RED II and the IEMD. There are amendments to existing legislation in the Czech Republic, which are trying to address the uncertainty to bring in the definition and coverage of the activities envisaged under energy communities. But what we're finding is that this progress is somewhat inadequate. There are elements of proposed amendments to the legislation which still fall short of the requirements for energy communities. For example, there are limitations of up to 1,000 people who can join the community, which contradicts the open access requirements under the European directives. Then we also identified some technical barriers, such as the lack of smart meters and the low voltage network in the Czech Republic to really incorporate the activities and the electricity generated by energy communities. And we also observed cultural barriers. The reality is many people in these territories do not want to move away from fossil fuels. They identify very closely with these carbon intensive and fossil fuel energy sources and are as such skeptical to make this transition. So what are we doing to address these situations other than characterizing the different barriers? We're actually proposing a very concrete set of actions, not only to the national and regional public authorities, but also to the energy companies and the regulators on what they can do to help overcome these barriers. Here you can see a bit of a template of each individual action where we spell out in great detail what needs to be done, why, who needs to take leadership on this, who are the involved stakeholders, where can you potentially get funding from. A key part of our project is scoping the overall financing arrangements in the Czech Republic to provide a bit of a menu of public and private funding sources for community energy action. I see I'm running out of time, but just to give you a little bit more of an insight on what we'll be producing, of course, this is the handbook which I mentioned to you, whereby we will be on existing guidance on how to put together an energy community, tailoring it to the Czech context using our analysis. The good practices which we've selected and are developing are for me a really interesting part of this project. Here on the right, you can see a map of the different places our good practices are coming from, the different sources of energies feeding into the energy communities. Shall these good practices will serve as inspiration and as a benchmark for covering energy communities and provide a variety of options on how to go about doing it in terms of energy sources and size, etc. And then for those interested and those who can speak in Czech, that we'll be having six different events in autumn of the end of this year. Three larger information sessions, more of a purely, let's say, dissemination exercise where we will carry out three half-day sessions in each of the three Czech just transition regions to basically promote knowledge of our handbook and our results. But then these will be followed by three tailor-made workshops. Now, the idea of this is that these will be full-day sessions for a smaller audience and the audience are particularly those who are really interested in the short or medium term coming together and assembling an energy community, and they may face certain barriers or challenges and want to discuss this with the expert team involved and indeed the local and regional authorities who will be attending the session. So apologies again for the technical difficulties. We are not used to Zoom. We are having internet issues here today, so it's a little bit of a unfortunate situation, but I hope you grasp the essence of our project, and both I remain to your disposal for questions, and we have the what looks like another Puyan, but is in fact our colleague David from the partner who's also Hello. Here and has been getting doing the hard work, basically liaising with the stakeholders and getting his hands dirty on the local and territorial dynamics. So if you have any questions, we'd be happy to answer those.
Thank you very much, Puyan, and indeed we managed. So I'm happy that we went through your presentation. We are definitely running out of time. This webinar is set for 1 hour, so that means we have 2 minutes, but maybe we can push it a bit further. But as I don't see, actually I do see some questions in the chat. So I will proceed with that, and then I'll jump if there's enough time with my questions. So Puyan, a question to you from George Stiff. Since you said that many in these regions don't want to move away from fossil fuels, is this reflecting mainly your views on entities, in example, utilities, or also citizens, especially if the latter, would you say it's useful to exploit their historic identity as the batteries of the country? Or is it that not really sufficient to convince them?
David, I think you've been speaking to the utilities companies and the citizens' organizations in the Czech Republic more than I have. Perhaps you have a better answer on this, but my sense is both, right? But please do confirm.
Okay. Do you hear me?
Yes. Perfect.
Okay. Yeah. Perfect. I only wanted to make sure. Okay. Maybe this problem with some, let's say, with some still positive relation to fossil fuels, all among the citizens and also the companies within these coal regions in the Czech Republic. This is something what is still remaining, what is, let's say, disappearing gradually with coming of young generation, of younger and younger people. This is slowly changing. So this is still visible in these regions, but I would like to say that maybe this is not the biggest trouble which we face too, and the biggest trouble, and this is not only related to the coal region in the Czech Republic. I think it will be typical for the Czech Republic as a whole, is the mentality of people, and I will explain what I mean. That there will be when the energy communities will start the operation, there will be the very, let's say, strong test of the mentality of people, because you all know mostly that during the summer, there will be a lot of surpluses of the electrical energy produced within the energy communities from photovoltaic panels and whatever. And this will cause very often that the prices of the electrical energy will drop down to zero, even let's say into the negative prices, -10, -2 Czech crowns or euro cents, something like that. But the people in energy communities will have to pay the let's say stable, the same price during all the year for the electrical energy. And this will be the main trouble, because if you have to pay as the consumer within the energy communities three Czech crowns, for example, for 1 kWh of energy during the winter, so it's very cheap, it's very fine, because from the official from the state energy company CES, it would be more expensive. Also, if you are the producer, if you deliver the energy with I think 2 crowns per kilowatt hour, for example, this is still better for you, because the Czech state company CES would buy it from US for 1 Czech crown only. So this is win-win situation, it's okay. But during the summer, when this electrical energy prices will drop down, so I am a little bit afraid, and also other experts are a little bit afraid, a lot of people will say, why should I pay 3 crowns for electrical energy when this energy is really on the zero prices, is very cheap, and why should I pay so expensive energy? But they are not aware that it's really the membership in the energy community is really advantageous in the long term horizon during all the year, but not only in one moment in one year season or something like that. So this is something what it's necessary to explain to people, to make really a lot of educational courses, the spreading of awareness. What are the real advantages? Energy communities, and to convince them that it is really, despite the fact that they will have to pay some higher price during the summer for some while. Yeah. So this is, I think, the big problem was with the mentality of people. Not so much the positive relation to fossil fuel, but this will be the hard test of mentality of people and their approach if they will be able to sustain in the energy communities.
Thank you very much.
David. <yeah.
laughs> I hope that satisfies George's question, which was a very
okay. So we have one more question in the chat, but as it's already 3 past, maybe just a quick answer to this one, a super, super quick one. Do you see the existing legislative barriers in Czech to have specific solutions that can be introduced quickly?
The amendments in itself are a right step towards addressing a lot of the issues which there are, but there are certain characteristics of the amendments which are not so clear to us why they are being included. For example, the limitations on 1,000 members. This contradicts the open access principles of energy communities. So sure, if the amendments can be amended to not include provisions such as this, that would be a very short, quick means of addressing the shortfall. David, maybe you have something else also to add on this.
Yes, of course. If you are talking about the current Czech legislation concerning the energy communities, in fact, there's only the, let's say, Basic Energy Act, which is somehow defining renewable energy sources and ways of the utilization, but there's no, let's say, no concrete chapter, no concrete clause concerning the energy communities. On the other hand, the Czech Energy Regulatory Office issued, I think it was 1 year ago, the new directive about the sharing of energy, of electrical energy in the block of flats in the housing residential areas. Yeah. So in fact, now in the Czech Republic is somehow possible to share the electrical energy in the building houses, in the block of flats, but it's only, how to say, 20% of all the needed legislation which we need for running the energy communities in total extent as it should be. Yeah. So we are waiting for the next two acts. This will be there will be novelizations, the update of the current Energy Act, and in this we call that Lex RES, Renewable Energy Sources 2. So in this Lex RES 2, there will be defined the energy communities, what they are, what legal forms they can have, how can they be running, what can be their operation model, what are the conditions of membership and something like that. But still, in this Lex RES 2, there will be most probably no concrete technical, let's say, concerns, technical parameters, how this energy flows to be shared can be operated and something like that. And this will be in Lex RES 3. So in the next Czech legislation act, which will be issued, I think, during next year. So there will be, let's say, gradual steps of these two legislation acts, and we will have to wait up to the end when this legislation will be completed. Yeah, so this is a little bit problematic and very complicated. So this is about the Czech legislation, and also when Jan was talking about this limitation of Czech energy communities within Lex RES2, that there will be limitation of maximally 1,000 members and territorial limitation of the municipality with the extended competencies. So this is also which is not in direct compliance with EU legislation, but if we are talking about a lot of barriers which Jan presented, we don't have. low voltage networks, which should be strong enough, they are in fact very weak. We don't have smart meters to measure the energy flows within the energy communities. We don't have energy data center which could monitorize all these smart meters and calculate all these prices and something like that.
I'm afraid that I really have to ask you because we are already 7 minutes after 12, and I really wanted to close this webinar with again this just transition kind of aspect. And George Stiff put to the chat question that I wanted to actually ask at the very end, and to ask you what are challenges and opportunities of doing energy communities in just transition coal regions versus other regions. So if you could very quickly, and this is a question to the three of you, even in one sentence, if possible, if you could answer to this, I would be grateful. And then we'll close the webinar. So Joanna, maybe we can start from you.
Okay, yes, I'll start. I'll try to be brief. Of course, energy communities are important to be created nationwide, but coal regions have a specific a challenge to tackle. I think that from our experience in Greece, citizens have a huge energy tradition. And they use this tradition in the energy community sector. I think it's crucial that during the just transition process, local communities access the benefits of the transition. I don't mean only the social benefits, but also the economic benefits. That's why energy communities are really crucial to be citizens based in these regions. And we need active citizens, not only the energy sector, but we need also active citizens in the just transition process. In Greece, we have a centralized governance mechanism. We don't want also a centralized RES energy system. We want transition and energy, just transition and energy transition to include local communities. And I think energy communities, specifically in coal regions, differ from any other part of Greece to that point. Trying to be brief.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Chris.
Yeah, no, maybe just to touch on what Ioana just said, but also to link it back to the financing aspect. You know, you see these regions that suddenly will now have an influx over the next 4 years of billions of euros. So, of course, it is a good thing on the one hand, but it's also a risk because you have the all sorts of, let's say, vultures, huge private companies that just want to quickly take a slice of the pie and make use of the public funds, but without any whatsoever concern about including the local community, as Ioana just said. So it's a huge opportunity, but a huge challenge at the same time. It's a battle of ideas. It's a battle of ideology and of political direction on whether we want to utilize these hundreds of millions of euros to build this bottom-up citizen-led energy communities that promote local energy sufficiency, promote electric mobility, promote energy efficiency, all sorts of projects, or we want to just install what Ioana perfectly named the monocultures of huge wind turbines or solar parks, which, okay, it's good because they're promoting renewable energy, which is great, we all agree with that, but all of the revenue actually exits the local community. So huge challenge, huge opportunity at the same time.
Thank you, Chris. And Poyan, would you like to add one sentence?
Well, I fully agree with what Ioana and Chris says. To echo specifically what Chris said on the scale of the challenges and opportunities, how I see it is that either community energy can be a very successful and large-scale catalyst, i.e. if it can play on the identity element, on the social acceptance of a region. If the conditions for it to succeed well are there, it's going to be a huge driver. But in places where there is already a barrier towards renewables, if people are not already inclined to be favorable towards this, the challenge will be greater than in other regions across Europe to change this mentality, to promote the education, to create this different mindset. So I think if it can catch the wind, it will surf very fast and far, changing the wind and the tide on this in places where it's not favorable is going to be a particular challenge. And we are seeing this as part of some studies we are doing in also Eastern German regions, where it's people simply do not accept it as a replacement towards a carbon intensive heritage which they have. So just echoing again what Chris said on the big opportunity it can present, but also where there's a challenge, this is also a difficult one to overcome.
Perfect. Thank you very much. It's almost 15 past 12, but we are still, I can still see that we have attendees with us listening. So thank you, first of all, to all of you, all panelists, for being with us, for joining us, for sharing your expertise and all those really, really insightful information. And thank you to all the listeners that stayed with us till the very end. And I would like to also invite you to our next webinar. As it's a series, the next one will be on the last Monday of June. And this time we'll look at the just transition process in Ukraine. So we'll look at just transition regions in Ukraine. So a very interesting topic. And I invite you to follow us on social media and so on. We'll be sharing, of course, all information. So again, thank you very, very, very much. Enjoy the rest of the day. And yeah, thank you again. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you all. Bye. Thanks.